Hello, I'm Yard to Crozier, and where the fuck were you?
Hello, I'm part of this complete breakfast. It's called tertiary education, yeah.
I don't care. What are we playing?
I don't know. I'm completely confused. I have no idea what I'm looking at right now.
Why are you even here? Why do I put up with you?
That's a question I'm sure many want answered. Because you need, like, your fucking weekly mandatory socialization.
Continue on the subject of the game, please.
Oh, okay, well, this is the original Grand Theft Auto. A little indie game by, what was it? What were they called? DMA?
Well, they're now called Rockstar. Yeah. At this point, they were called DMA Design. They were most famous at the time for having developed Lemmings.
Lemmings!
For the famous puzzler for the Amiga and PC. Also, Lemmings 2, The Tribes. Which took the original formula of having, like, 7 different abilities for lemmings and multiplied the number of abilities by, like, 50.
Jesus, really?
It was a bit silly.
See, that's... I think that's one of those things where the original lemmings succeeded, where complexity came from simplicity.
You had ninja lemmings and clown lemmings.
What did they do?
Super lemmings and... quite a variety of different things. And space lemmings. And I think there were gardening lemmings as well.
Oh, that's not a thing to hit.
That's a great start. Any particular reason you're playing the original GTA before the series was good?
I was working on assignments up until, like... okay. Up until about Friday at 3 when I had it. Oh, that's the car I'm supposed to steal. Okay.
I don't feel like your head's in the game.
I'm trying to do two things at once. Fucking anus. Oh, hey, don't shoot
me. Well, you can't blame lack of platelets this week.
No, now it's just fucking garden variety exhaustion. So, yeah, I was doing fucking uni work up until, like, Friday afternoon, and I handed that shit in, grumbled at the futility of it all, and then went home and just ignored, you know, made a very concerned effort to not think at all. And then you said, what game have you got planned? I was like... what's fucking boring, but I find slightly amusing and won't take me much work to get? Oh, GTA.
Well, you say it wouldn't take a lot of work to get.
And then it became a weird amount of work.
It was an ass to get running.
Hey, go away.
That policeman was not impressed by you having passed the mission.
Damn it. Police, how am I supposed to, like, get away from a life of crime if you thwart my efforts to, you know...
How do you escape from the police in this period of the series?
I honestly cannot remember.
I seem to remember you can only do it by picking up star pickups. Of course, in...
that might be it, actually.
Time of GTA 4, everyone was spoiled.
God damn it.
Anyway, you could...
I thought I got the fucking...
What's it counting down to?
I don't know.
You failing, apparently.
I handed that thing in. You're not going to rip out my lungs with a claw hammer, you ass nugget.
Too slow, ass
twist white. Off your nipples with a fucking Stilson wrench.
Well, now your energy's coming back up. Maybe drink some of that Coke you've got.
Yeah, well, I'm also trying to wean myself off, like, too much caffeine. And I didn't drink any coffee at all the last 3 days. And now I've had a Coke.
You...
what?
I question your commitment. Dropping caffeine, doing all this university work.
No, don't worry, like, I'm one more frustratingly poorly organized assessment away from just dropping it and following my dreams of becoming a professional wrestler. Then you can laugh at me for being useless.
Well, as, what's his name said, don't worry about the money, just do what you love.
Well, you know, I can assure you I'm not worried about the money.
I can tell.
Alright, what's this task? The angels. Bubby, good bubby. Good bubby.
Oh, I hate it when someone splits with my shit.
Who's seen Bad Boy Bubby? You should like YouTube this, the good bubby scene. That'll be fun for you. What have I got police attention for now? Or is
you,
it just not gone
had
away?
It. You already
so that
had
just
it.
Alright.
Yeah, it's just stuck
I
around.
I forgot all this shit. Like, it's been so long since I've played
well,
the
series never really became apocalyptically popular until GTA 3, did it?
That's the thing. Barely any people really gave a shit about 1 and 2.
What's in that box?
Probably
it might
nothing.
Be a pickup. It might be a reduced wanted level pickup.
Might be.
But you're not gonna go back for it, I see.
I'm steering a car with, like, this horrible pan and zoom with the arrow keys. Like, this is what I'm doing.
Makes you wonder why this game didn't do as well as its 3D successors.
I, like, GTA 3 when it first came out was a fucking... that was insane. We went apeshit for that.
Yeah, I think the main issue with these top-down games is that you can't see more than about 20 feet in front of you.
No, and it does to try and be helpful, it does this like little pan and zoom, where it's like, oh, well, you're going fast, we'll zoom out, but it just makes me seasick, because it's just doing it constantly.
Did you play GTA Chinatown Wars?
No, but I heard it was alright.
Well, they were wrong.
Oh, okay. I don't trust you because you just hate things and fun.
A lie. I really liked Wolfenstein New Order.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, I say really like.
Dicks.
That keeps happening.
God, they bust you easy in this. Yeah. I'm fucking... This is... Modern gaming's made me fat and complacent.
Jeez, I mean, you only stole one car.
Alright, the cops aren't bugging me now. Give me a motorcycle, dick.
Yes. I think the cops even have to see you commit a crime to raise you wanted level.
I'm not sure, though.
Well,
it's gonna be a journey of discovery. Hey, I should do my biking tour of this.
Yeah, let's drive around the city obeying traffic laws, and we'll see how far we get.
Wait, okay.
Wait, that arrow's pointing at that motorbike.
I forget what I have to do. Do I have to steal the motorbike, or do I have to kill a bunch of
those guys? Imagine those people in black will object.
Okay. Now the exciting game of trying to shoot and kill in the original.
Yes, the less popular George R. R. Martin.
Alright, that's... Drive, you fucking...
See, using bikes is even worse, because they're much faster than cars. And if you're coming up on a big wall, you have even less time to react.
Alright, I'm feeling pretty safe here.
Alright, well, shall we talk about what's going on this week in the world of gaming and popular culture?
No, I'd rather discuss educational theory. That's what this is about, isn't it? I thought we were going to do a whole drown out of education theory. Okay, no.
Well, wish into one hand, shit in the other, see which one fills up first, motherfucker. So we're going to talk about...
What if I wished for shit?
Well, then you've run rings around me logically. Let's talk about the fact that E3's next week.
Oh, Jesus.
Yes, the big...
The annual investor meeting that E3's become.
The annual... gaming media event, which is just a big happy clappy circle jerk for everyone.
Well, it hasn't really, you know...
What are your E3 predictions?
Nintendo to unveil new planet.
Well, that's not a prediction, is it? You just know that.
What, the new planet?
Well, interestingly, Nintendo are not... What's that saying? Shit on my machine. Have you been shitting on a machine again?
Apparently. What the fuck?
Well, apparently for the second year running, Nintendo aren't doing a press conference. I mean, they have booths.
God damn it!
They're doing their booths and shit. You're the worst crim.
I forgot that you had to get back to the phones for, like, no discernible reason. Like, in the modern ones, it's like, you did the thing. Congratulations! Now it's like, you have to get there and back, and that... That fucks me up because I have no idea where I'm going, and I'm steering with fucking arrows.
This game came out before everyone had mobiles.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So, Nintendo aren't doing a press conference. They're doing, like, booths and shit.
Adventure!
That was exciting. Microsoft are doing the press conference.
Well,
Sony
have gone to Nintendo Directs. Like, they've been doing that for ages.
Ubisoft are doing one. EA are doing one.
Ubi?
Nintendo apparently decided they're playing a different game to everyone else.
Nintendo are the manic pixie dream girl of game developers.
Well, if you like.
They started out there, they're just getting weirder and weirder, and they don't care. E3 will just be like... Fucking Miyamoto in not matching shoes, singing a song about adventure.
Well, the two hand puppets that he keeps clapping them together and then admonishing them for fighting. And seemingly getting more and more genuinely angry about it.
It's the only thing that can actually make Miyamoto angry is...
That you're ruining my presentation, Muffles and Scruffles!
Muffles and Scruffles.
Thank you for repeating a joke I just made.
Meg, I'm laughing about it to myself, you sack.
What an interesting insult.
Once when I was on the door, someone called me Jelly Nuts. And they said that aggressively, like, fuck you, Jelly Nuts. And I laughed my fucking ass off. And it was like, one of those sarcastic laughs where I'm laughing at him. Like, I was genuinely, I just thought it was genuinely fucking hilarious. And the other guard was laughing too.
I can see where that goes. They say Jelly Nuts. You say, what do you mean, Jelly Nuts? And then they knee you in the balls.
No, because that would actually necessitate them getting close to me and hitting me, which is what people who are threatening you never really do.
Yeah, yeah. Nintendo, one thing we do know Nintendo are announcing, thanks to a leaked photo of their boothery, is something called Mario Maker.
That looks like it could be interesting.
I think, by the looks of it, a 3DS affair. I could be wrong.
Well, I mean, I don't know where I'm going. The arrows are not helpful. They point me into the direction of nothing.
Don't start a sentence that's continuing one topic and then immediately change the topic.
I'm not changing the topic. It's...
Well, you're going on a
shit.
Well, you're going on
a
tangent.
The topics are like my driving. There's a goal, and I'm trying to get there, but then there's a dead end.
Are you enjoying the angry energy infusing this video, viewers? So Mario Maker, I guess, is the thing where you make Mario levels.
Yeah, there's been a really vibrant and healthy Mario mod community for like fucking ages.
Well,
so
the ROM hacking bunch. Yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean, you know, there's been a lot of. A lot of fun and a lot of very disturbing, insane levels.
Have you heard of Psycho Waluigi?
No.
It's a game made by like an indie developer who decided it was a shame that Waluigi never had his own game when everyone else in the Mario, Luigi, Wario, Waluigi quartet have had one.
Yeah, well, even Peach had her own game.
Yeah, but Mario had to be in it.
Yeah.
So some guy made a platform game where you play as Waluigi being really evil and taking over the world.
Huh.
With psychic powers. Apparently it's... Well, not apparently, because I've seen videos of it, but it is actually quite really well made. Really captures the essence of 16-bit platforming.
Oh, wow, cool. I might have a look at that.
Couldn't sell it, ever, but... it's rather strange the amount of effort that went into it, but there it is.
I like things like that where there's no reason for the level of effort beyond personal passion. I respect that.
Right.
And, you know, if it produces a good, fun game, then good. That means I get to play a thing.
Well, it's almost like your professional wrestling dream, isn't it? Just pursue that goal and die in a dumpster somewhere.
Oh, I murdered someone and now the police are upset with me. God damn, is there... Okay. I'd like to think that I could push a button and find a map. I'm terrified of doing that because I'm afraid I'll either shut the game down, shut the record down... Or some combination of the both. We'll just crash.
Yeah, best not to worry about it. Why do you need a map? There's an arrow.
Yeah, that's... the arrow has repeated... The arrow doesn't take into account things like bodies of water that I can't get across.
Well, no. They didn't handhold you back in my day.
And this is what I mean. Like, I'm trying to... now we're back to the fucking adventure bridge again.
I wonder if Mario Maker will be anything along the lines of that one WarioWare game they made.
Great.
Where you could design your own games for it. Basically, had to learn a visual-oriented programming language to do so.
Really?
Yeah, it was called WarioWare DIY. You could upload it to, like, the Wii Store and play it on the Wii.
Huh. Didn't even know about that.
But,
another great example of Nintendo's brilliant promotional work for their interesting little ideas.
I'm a little iffy about games that base themselves around user-made content, like Little Big Planet, for example.
Hmm.
I mean, it seems like you're gonna have to wade through a lot of shit to find good levels.
Well, I mean, that's where I'd hope there'd be, like, maybe a community voting thing,
well,
but I mean,
rather,
that's...
Well, all we have to do is make a shit level with My Little Pony on it, and that'll get 5 stars.
Yeah, I know that that's not a flawless system, but it's at least a little better than just nothing, you know? I'd rather there being a voting system than just wade through the shit, because without a voting system, you really are just going to be wading through shit.
I'd rather cry bollocks to user-driven combat-based games, user-driven content-based games, and just, you know, play games that have been designed by professionals to be fun.
Well, you know, they do make Mario games. I'm not opposed to this. I like the idea of them putting out, like, something that allows people to, you know, do what they do and put it into an area where I can kind of get to it easily.
Well, I guess in the 12 million Mario platformers they have made, most of them in the last couple of years, they've sort of used up all the possible ideas they could have had for level design.
Yeah, so now they're just like, you guys do it.
This is
them fucking done, yeah.
Throwing up their hands. But really, if they've run out of creative level creation ability, what possible hope have you got, Mr. Non-Nintendo employed man?
Fuck off. Oh, my car's making noises that aren't good.
Yeah, that'll happen when the police smash it up a bit. Oh, I remember now. That's how you lose a wanted level. You get a bit of a spray job.
Car's a different colour, I don't understand.
You know,
it isn't even a different colour.
You know, the term spray job sounds like something different to what it is.
Sex.
That sounds like something on the back page of the brothel catalogue.
It's like reverse bukkake.
It incorporates One of them lawn sprinklers and a lot of prostitutes doing a lot of...
Oh, don't get angry. Thank you.
And a lot of prostitutes spitting into a bucket.
Just spit into the bucket.
I wonder if you can get sex toy themed lawn sprinklers that you can fill with piss.
I'm pretty sure you either can or... Oh, okay. Hey.
I got a patent, that shit. Drive under the crane. Hey, see? We're doing something.
Alright. Under the crane? Down here.
Yeah, where it says. Possibly not there. Under the yellow thing you saw earlier.
Yeah, but it...
Just park under it.
I don't think I can get under it. Look.
Well, just try.
Oh, okay. It's not a solid object.
No, of course. What would make you think that? Try again. But park properly this time. I wonder if you can stay in the car while they're doing that.
I think you can, and I don't think that ends well for you.
Hey, you just got $5,000 when you've already got $45,000. This doesn't seem like the most efficient money-making scheme.
Oh, I got a gun, that's right.
Yeah, shoot someone. Why not? It's GTA, after
all. Look at the bullets slowly move. Like, look how hard it is.
You can barely see the bullet.
Oh, accidentally got one. Nice. Considering how hard it is to kill you things, and it's your fault.
Yeah, GTA 3, I remember, tried to make it more like a 3D version of this. And it wasn't terribly good for that.
Well, yeah, you know, the thing about...
It still had rampages you could do.
Yeah, I prefer with a bit of character, to be honest. Like, a little bit, like...
Well, this has a certain amount of character.
A degree. Like, you can pick characters that you are at the start, but, you know, it doesn't matter. You all look like this little bald dude in the yellow shirt.
Yeah, that's the weird thing. Before we started recording, you had to choose from a number of pictures.
I chose Bubba because Bubba. Hey, come back.
And I don't know how that applies to gameplay. Maybe it's like the save file.
Possibly.
But anyway, other things that we speculate for E3. Now, Microsoft are doing a presentation, and
a Fritos Mountain Dew Extreme Microsoft presentation presents.
And considering the fiasco that was Microsoft's presentation last year, where they started chucking out features before they'd finished announcing them, I predict that there's either this year Microsoft's gonna go full-blown 100% self-denial backslapping, or there's going to be a rather pleasing undertone of hand-wringing going on during Microsoft's presentation.
Which things would you like them to disavow or wring their hands off?
Well, I'd like them basically just to apologize for being alive. And maybe, like, release...
I like that you keep your goals simple and possible.
And maybe release all their exclusives to PC. And it's funny we should say that, because Dead Rising 3 has just been announced to be released on PC.
I'd like their exclusives to be released on PC, too.
Which was just about the only half-decent Xbox One exclusive.
Yeah, like, there's your thing, Capcom.
More nails for the X-Bone. So many nails in that bone, it's starting to look like an S&M-themed wedding bouquet.
You can see those pictures on the internet. Ooh, PCCD.
Yeah.
Oh, just lord. So,
and I expect you'll be looking forward to that, because you played a bit of Dead Rising 3 in the bar, didn't you? But you don't want an X-Bone.
Oh, lord, no. It is absolutely not worth the X many dollars to...
Well, 100 less if you get the new, like, version of it that doesn't have a Kinect in it.
Doesn't have a bunch of shit here. Oh, armor. Cool.
How many more things must we get rid of before you love us? Cry, Microsoft.
Please love me. Please.
Well, the other story I heard, continuing the PC port theme, is that the Xbox One controller is going to have Windows drivers added.
Good.
So it will be just like the Xbox 360 controller. You can play PC games with it.
I honestly think that's good for Microsoft in the long run.
Well, you've already got an Xbox 360 controller. The Xbox One doesn't really change anything.
Yeah, I suppose. Like, it doesn't have any extra features, really, does it?
It's not like the PS4 controller with a big useless tablet in the middle of the
That's so dumb. What can you do with that? Like, what can you do with that?
Well, I'd made this point in a couple of columns, but while it's pretty much pointless for all hand controls, it's ideally situated for nose and tongue control. So if you're in the middle of the game and suddenly an ice cream minigame comes up, you can just lick the middle of the controller to make the ice cream
go away. Because it's such a small space. Like, you can't really draw with it. You can't really write with it.
Oh, they just threw it in there because they needed a hardware gimmick to pretend that they had to massively redevelop hardware for the new console to convince everyone that why they had to buy it and not just rely on the existing ones.
Here's our new console. The games that really make the graphics worthwhile won't be out for another 2 years. Bye. Yes,
but please enjoy this thing in the middle of the controller covered in saliva.
It's sticky. Oh, God.
So that points to me more towards
Did it even
Microsoft having a very hand-wringing sort of event this year.
Did it even do anything in Did it even do anything in Killzone? Like, wasn't some of their early
In Killzone? Yes, it basically functioned as a D-pad. You rubbed your finger in one of four ways to control your little helper robot.
Ah.
And Infamous Second Son had it as basically just another button to have contextual button presses with. Like, rub the thing to open the door.
Right, so useless.
Yeah, useless. Completely. I mean, maybe they can come up with a game that proves it was necessary, but I don't see it happening. Personally.
Again, the idea of having a touchpad there isn't... Or a touchpad somehow isn't wholly bad, but the thing's too small. Like, what... I'm not sure, like, how, because, you know, there needs to be some sort of tactile association.
I don't think making it bigger would help. I think it wasn't necessary at all.
Oh, no, but that's my point, is they couldn't do it big enough to make it do anything of value, because, like, lunatics insane shit using the Wii U tablet. Like, there's art things for the Wii U tablet, and you can do that because it's large enough to actually, you know, draw a fucking thing.
Well, it's not quite the same, is it? Because it's not a screen, it's just a button.
No, but that's what I mean. Like, it has none of the even possible function that a touch dealie could have, so it just shouldn't be there. I'm struggling to think of a way that it could be used that isn't just shitty button.
Well, no, I've devoted much thought to this as a game critic, and speaking as someone who's played all the video games, I can't envision any possible purpose except for the aforementioned tongue thing.
Possibly. Do that. Someone do that. Like, someone just... There should be, like, maybe, like, an oral sex practice game for PS4.
The hygiene people will be up in arms.
Well, you don't even like
vaccinating. They don't even like vaccinating their kids. They're gonna love having to lick something.
That kind of counts as a ghetto vaccination. Here you go, kids. Lick the pole. Lick the pole. There you go. I know, it tastes bad. You gotta...
Yeah. Lick the 8-year-old with chicken pox. Come on. Everyone have a slurp.
My dad got chicken pox as an adult, and that was fucked up. Like, there's some... Like, I understand...
Yeah, there's a reason why people say get it while you're a kid.
Yeah, like, he had to go to hospital. Like, when was the last time you've known someone had to go to hospital because of, like, a virus? Like, it's scary. Normally you get, like, I got measles. Like, oh, that sucks. And you're home for, like, 2 weeks.
Well, everyone with AIDS, for a start.
Oh, yeah, but, like, AIDS is AIDS. Like, chicken pox... Getting hospitalized for chicken pox is, like...
That sounds like a bit of down-home wisdom for the kids. Sitting on the porch in your rocking chair. Now remember, kids... AIDS is AIDS,
AIDS
and
is
corn
AIDS.
Is corn.
AIDS is not corn. Well, I mean, that, you know, again, like...
Don't you put no AIDS in the corn. That ain't what Mama used to make. I don't know what the fuck accent I'm going for there.
It's kind of, I'm getting, like, a bit of Maine. Stephen Colbert, like, on... Oh God, what was the name of the show? He played, Garth in Wayne's World.
Oh, Dana Carvey.
Dana Carvey, yeah. He had his own show for one season. It was a very bizarre and rather funny sketch comedy show. But one of the things he did was this weird sketch with Stephen Colbert called Racists in Maine. And it's just these two guys, these two skinheads sitting on a porch rocking back and forth, just talking to each other in these Maine accents going, corn coming early this year? Yup. Jews are responsible for all wars? Yep. And just going back and forth like that for like 5 minutes and...
Okay.
A combination of the accents and just the innocuous statements before the racist statements just made it really funny for me.
Okay. We're just going to have to take your word for that, since nobody's thought of Dana Carvey for at least 15 years.
Your show was funny. You should YouTube it. That's good.
Well, whatevs.
It's a little bit like, God damn it. Can't think and turn at the same time. Never mind. That's What's always our next
been,
topic?
That's always been your problem, hasn't it?
Yeah, I've actively said this. Like, it's just... hey, you have difficulty with it, too.
Don't do pretend, I?
Yes. There's bits in the Doom video where you're, like, trying to talk and Doom at the same time, and you said, this is hard. And I'm like, yeah, it's tricky to do two things at once. It's distracting when someone's trying to talk to you while you're playing a video game.
Oh, so that's like, a shame, because that's the entire thrust of this series.
Yeah, I know, but the goal of this is more the talk than the video game, which is why it's okay, I run into shit and die all the time.
Apparently.
Yeah. What's the next topic?
Well, I was just going to say, continuing the E3 theme.
Oh, yeah, that's right, we're talking about E3.
That I'm hoping...
Ooh, we're going to get that Jeffrey card.
Huh. That I'm hoping that there'll be some locking down of stuff relating to VR tech.
I wouldn't mind seeing that.
Because that's an innovation that I think will actually add something.
Just come on, Nintendo. VR goggles, a proprietary like steering wheel controller, and an F-Zero game. I will any amount of money I will fucking pay.
People talk about combining the Oculus VR with like motion controls, and I'm like, no, don't do that. That's the whole idea of Oculus VR is to add immersion. Yes, motion controls subtract immersion. They're fighting each other.
I don't know, I think motion controls can add immersion, but...
I don't think they can. The ideal for immersion in-game is that you think in your brain, do thing, and then you instantly do thing, yes?
That's called life.
Yes, exactly. It's just like one-to-one yes, thought... One-to-one thought control is...
Better than life as...
One-to-one thought control is the ultimate goal of immersive game control. Yes?
Yes.
But at the moment, the closest thing we have to that is pressing buttons on a controller, because it is such a small movement that you barely have to think about. Adding, like, big arm waves and stuff is a much bigger motion. It's moving away from immersion.
Well, the idea is, though, it integrates the motions as typically understood by the human body with the motions occurring on the screen.
Well, that's great for some kind of physical training device, but it's not something I'd unwind with while I just want to have fun with a game.
See, that's the thing. I spent loads of time getting wrecked with my bartender friends and playing Wii Tennis.
Right.
And that was shitloads of fun for us.
Right. But, yes, I mean, it's a physical exercise thing.
Yeah, that was kind of half the fun. Like, when you're like...
I play video games to unwind at the end of a long day. I do not unwind by getting all...
A long day of playing video games, sitting at this computer writing about video games, talking about video games.
Well, exactly, man. It's hard work. I don't want to have to, like, get all sweaty and
what do you play as an unwind game? Do you have something that you go back to? Because for me, it's like Street Fighter, because I can play it for 5 minutes and then go away.
Well, Euro Truck Simulator.
Really? So it actually really legitimately, you Euro Truck, you're one of those people now?
Well, what do you mean, one of those people?
I mean, one of those people who plays Euro Truck Simulator a lot. That's a distinct category
of those
people.
Well, I don't play it by itself. I play it to unwind and listen to podcasts. Because I find I can't just listen to a podcast. I have to be doing something with my hands.
You know, I think we found what you'd be really good for if, like, you know, everyone decided you were boring tomorrow. Like, you could just get your trucker's license. Think about it. You're alone. You get to listen to podcasts.
I can't even drive a car.
Huh?
I can't even drive a car.
Well, yeah.
Well, I know broadly how to drive a car, but I haven't passed my test.
I mean, you know, we can work on that. I'm just saying we've found something that you might actually enjoy. You know, you could...
Well, this problem with that, as demonstrated in the trucking video, is that I would cause massive fatal accidents every single day.
Oh, that's only because, you know, you haven't done the test. You don't have much experience
yet. Well, I did the test a few times. I couldn't pass because I'm just too much occupied with my dreamy dreams.
Daydreaming, can't drive a car.
I dream a dirty dream of you, baby.
Can't drive, thinking about tits.
I fall asleep amid the flowers for a couple of hours on a beautiful day.
What's that song?
It's Daydream in Blue.
Oh, okay.
By Eye Monster.
Oh, I don't know that band.
Okay.
I don't know a lot of bands that aren't like 90s hip-hop.
So I'm anticipating a fairly humdrum E3, because let's face it, it's only a year since the major new consoles came out. I don't think they're going to announce much more that they didn't already tease last year.
I mean, if we're lucky, there might be a bunch of games, because that was pretty threadbare last year, and 1 year into the cycle, you know, there's a good shot that like, hey, we remembered we actually have to make games that you'll... buy a console to play.
Well, games do take a while to develop these days, and each new like generation of hardware adds more stumbling blocks in the way of third-party developers.
Can I stop giving this fucking lunatic cars yet?
Is this the mission? Just give him cars?
Yeah, well, the arrow hasn't changed. It's still like, feed me cars.
Okay, bring him another car then.
Burke, feed me. Maybe try and
find a really good car.
Well, I've been finding some really fast, like, that was, some topless sports cars and shit.
Well, maybe try to get to them through without smashing it up a whole bunch as well.
I've been completely good with the last, like, three.
Yeah, right.
Totes. Look, there's a sports utility vehicle. All right, I just gave him one of those. I don't think he wants the same thing over and over again. That looks kind of engine-y.
That looks street racer-y.
Yeah, I know, I'm trying to... come to Gabriel!
Oh, there's someone standing by the side of my car. I better slow down and see what he wants.
It's a guy running up to my door yammering. I'll wind down my window.
Yep, this will never end poorly. No much demand for these either, apparently.
Oh, Jesus, what do you want? Just tell me.
Well, he wants to give you $6,000.
Well, it's in excellent condition, so is that.
Yeah, that's why you got a bit more for it, I think.
God, if stealing cars made money this easy, I'd be a car thief.
Yes.
Everyone should do that. See, this is what the great ideas that Grand Theft Auto gives you.
Shame about that whole law and criminal justice system thing.
What are those, really? It's just an impressive fascist force of the man.
Basic tenets that are the root of civilization?
Disinterested third party. It helps reduce violence in society.
There's no such thing as a completely disinterested third party.
Well, no, I mean, it's like objectivity. You can't really be objective, but if you have it as an aim, you can mitigate some of the worst.
So this is why I always went for the Icarus ending in Deus Ex.
What was that?
That was the one where you basically say, you know what, humanity is shit at ruling itself, let's just let an AI do it.
You know, I'd actually accept that. Like, at this point, it'd be like, yeah, why not?
From a philosophical standpoint, it makes the most logical sense for an AI to be the ruler of the world.
It has no vested interests.
Yes, exactly. We could just program it to say, you know, make sure humans are all right.
That was kind of like the Will Smith iRobot. I didn't actually hate that movie, despite Will Smith.
Although, you know, if you put an AI in charge of the world and say, you know, make the world ideal for human life, the first thing it'll probably do is slaughter about half the human population.
I don't know.
I would.
Like,
I mean, every problem is rooted in overpopulation.
Well, that and population mismanagement, I think, is a thing as well.
Well, how would you solve everything?
Well, I mean,
I say, kill everyone we don't need. Like maybe everyone,
if an AI is running things, war's going to be obsolete. So you take the defense funds and put them toward things like education and spacefaring, and then we just start colonizing, like, you know, the moon and shit.
I think that will always run into the problem of people.
It's a topless... It's a convertible. How is there not demand for an aqua convertible? Just give me my money. Let me stop doing this mission.
Well, it is a hideous color.
It's like... That was popular in, like, 1995.
Well... Maybe this is just the default mission you do now because you fucked up all the other ones.
That's possible.
I seem to remember that was how these early GTAs worked. If you fucked up all the missions they gave you, they just said, yeah, just, you know, fanny about for the rest of the time.
How about a cab?
Yeah,
want a cab?
See if he wants a cab. The cops have taken an interest.
Nah. They don't need to be interested in me.
Oh, he said something different there.
He said buns. Oh, one more
shot. You were supposed to be capturing cabs, you fool. Why didn't you register that?
Was I?
Yeah.
Was it cabs or cars?
I remember now, when I played this game when I was a kid, there was a mission where you had to steal some taxis and take them to the crane.
Oh, okay.
This must be that mission, and now you're going
Shit.
To get busted because you don't know how to move your ass.
Well, that and, you know, if you touch a cop, it's just boop.
Well, yes, that's how it works. Because cops are all superheroes.
Yeah. They're not a bunch of fat dudes. That's right, I need cabs, don't I?
I think in GTA 4 you could pretend you were surrendering to the cops and then duff them up.
Yeah, cool. I don't remember that. Do you remember True Crime, Streets of LA?
Yes.
I actually have fond memories of that game.
Sleeping Dogs was a sort of the unofficial third game of that series.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It was originally going to be True Crime Hong Kong, but there was, you know,
licensing issues.
Copyright mishmashes. The developer changed hands a couple of times.
Huh.
The usual stuff.
Because I heard the sequel, Streets of New York, was terrible, but I quite liked Streets of LA. I thought it made for some interesting changes to the theme of GTAs.
Never played it myself. As I understand it, it was a game with a moral choice system, yes? You were an undercover cop, and instead of good or evil, it was good cop or bad cop.
Yeah, like if you went berserk and shot people, the police would go, there's a rogue police officer and shit like that. It wasn't really what I'd call a moral choice system exactly. Like, there were better ways of finishing. Like, it was a very plot-oriented game. You went through stages.
Yes, Sleeping Dogs was like that.
Yeah,
Yes.
You went through stages, and, like, there were basically ways where if you got, like, the shitty ending of, shit. Hey. If you got the shitty ending of a certain mission, you'd get, like, one ending, and then you had to go back into the mission again, and you'd find, like, the better, sort of completion of it,
and then you'd get
out into another set of stages, and you'd expand on the plot, you'd get more stages.
Yes, I remember now. There were various plot paths you could take.
Sort of branching plots. Like, sort of. It wasn't really, like, what you'd call... There was a true ending that you were meant to get to. It had actually quite a good hand-to-hand combat system. Some reasonably fun stuff, like you could shoot the petrol caps of cars while you're driving in a car and, like, blow the car up. You could shoot the wheels,
shit
like that.
That's the rule rather than the exception these days, isn't it?
Yeah, what else? I just plot-wise, it was kind of fun. Like, there was a whole bunch of stages pretty much based on Big Trouble in Little China.
Okay, thank you for that impromptu game review. Retro game review. Did you play Sleeping Dogs? Not to be confused with Watch Dogs, of course.
I have it. I haven't downloaded it yet. It's on my Steam thing.
Watch Dogs, the game that came out recently to the meh heard round the world.
I know. That's literally like...
Well, it couldn't live up to the hype, but then what could?
I know, that's... All my friends on Facebook who are going batshit for this thing, and it's just... They're all like, and it's like, yeah, well, what were you expecting? It's not...
Well, I'll tell you what I was expecting. A halfway not boring game, and that was slightly disappointing.
So it's really boring?
I did find it boring, yes, but my review's coming out this week, so shut up.
Oh, but tell us... now I gotta get to, like, a phone or something before they tell me I failed, even though I did what I was asked.
Bam. You missed it. You went straight past it, you dolt.
I was looking at the road.
Man, platelets or no platelets, we just can't help you,
can
we?
Hey!
Oh, now you have to waste some son of a bitch.
This is... putting his penis somewhere else. Penis. Gets in trouble. Penis.
So, just as a general message for everyone who tends to follow E3 coverage this week, keep things in perspective, and remember that everyone who's talking secretly thinks you're a dick.
I think one of the big complaints that I've seen about it in the past few years has always been there's not enough stuff for the fucking actual gamers. It all feels like a shareholders conference. It's like, yeah, that's what it is now. Like, that's, you know, Nintendo has the Nintendo Directs, so...
Well, this is a point I make in my column this week, actually, which I had to write before I knew anything about what was going on in E3.
Why is that? Like, surely...
Because I write my columns a week in advance, and the Escapist wanted to do, like, E3 week. And I can't make zero punctuation with enough expedience, so I'm just doing a column about it. But my point was that E3 is basically the only major, like, calendar event for in the terms of general public perception of the games industry. And it's our equivalent to the Academy Awards, in that it's basically a just load of back slapping for the richest motherfuckers in the industry.
George C. Scott refused his Academy Award once, and unlike Marlon Brando, who did it for, like, you know, sort of nice reasons, he just refused it because he said it was a meat market.
Nice.
Yeah.
Whereas,
come here, you jerk.
Well, I would just finally, you completed a sodding mission.
Yay!
Well, I find the Academy Awards just fucking absolutely excruciating to watch.
Oh, yeah, they're terrible. And they're pointless.
So, like, oh, you people, you're the loveliest people in the world. That includes the Dalai Lama, because we had fun on a film set or something.
I mean, that, and, you know, we discuss this all the goddamn time. It's... There is a... It's like AAA title. Like, there's a genre fucking, of Oscar
fucking,
movie.
Fucking worthies. I even hate the word worthies.
Yeah.
Oscar worthy? Fuck you.
I mean, so many times, like, you know, interesting... It's kind of like how every, like, Miss Universe is for women around the world. And yet, every fucking woman looks the same. Like, it's all that very one specific form of beauty. And it's
well,
like,
that
this is boring.
Well, that you could understand, because our society does have an ideal for physical attractiveness.
I think that... I don't know. It doesn't make sense to me.
Well, they vary from person to person, but there is a generally accepted... my ideal for beauty for both genders.
I suppose I'm like just peculiar in my tastes.
Big tits and big bums for the ladies, and big defined musculature for the fellas. But my point was, E3 is the Academy Awards for gaming, but we also need like a Cannes Film Festival, something that's you know, driven by critics. Something that
Yahtzee made.
Something that bases its, you know, mission on bringing exposure to the less known stuff.
Well, that was fun.
I mean, Cannes, you know, fails in various places in practice, but
intent is at
least
better.
I admire the principle that runs through it.
I like
that it's themed around a competition, and the people who judge the competition have got no vested interest.
Mm.
So all that best of E3 awards, that's just media circle jerk bullshit. But the Palme d'Or at the Cannes Festival is actually an accolade that people have to fight for.
Yeah, it's won by interesting fucking films.
Yes, we need something like that. You know, I was telling you before we recorded, one of my ambitions is to make enough money so that when I die, I can put it into an investment fund that can fund an annual prize for interesting and innovation in game development.
The Golden Crowshaw.
Yes, couldn't call it the Yahtzee, because Hasbro would be all over that shit.
Yeah, but I think Golden Crowshaw has a nice ring to it. Also, I want the statuette to be just, like, angry. I want it to have a filthy, disgusted, angry face on it.
It's basically just a little spray-painted bobblehead of me.
Oh, fuck you.
Is that egotistical, to want to do such a thing?
Yes.
But it's for the...
You have to ask that?
It's just to encourage an improvement of the industry. I'm not saying...
I didn't say it's bad egotistical. So this is the thing. Like, egotistical is not in and of itself bad. Bad egotism is usually narcissism.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's where, you know, you believe yourself to be the greatest example of fucking anything. Like, wanting to, you know, devote something of what you've done to benefit other people is, like, egotistical, but it's also, like, you know, so what? That could be really good if there was, like, a Golden Crowshaw that encouraged innovation in gaming.
Well, wanting to do something to benefit other people, even if it is based on the assumption that you make great stuff, is still a selfless attitude.
Well, I mean, you know, there's an argument that all altruism is selfishly motivated because it makes you feel good to do it, but that's...
I subscribe to that argument.
Well, I mean, again, yeah, so do I, but it's also a quibble. If the end result is you doing good things, then so what?
I actually tweeted this week this...
You actually tweeted? Wow, I tweeted an idea... You never used that thing enough.
I tweeted an idea that came to me that maybe the true egotism is to not put anything out and just assume no one would get it if you said anything.
I think it's a bit more insane. I mean, especially these days, like, there's someone to get everything.
Well, my point was, to not say or publish anything is to imply the inability to perceive any perception other than their own. Because they feel like, you know, the universe ends when they die, or at least nothing really matters happens after that. They got no interest in putting out something that will survive.
Shit!
They got no interest in putting out anything that will survive them.
Yeah, you know, their death ends their universe, and what, you know, what value, yes, is there?
That was my point.
I was trying to,
like,
sum it up.
Like, the example of that sort of egotism...
You were waffling this time.
An example I would put forward of that sort of egotism would be Carl Pilkington. And I was saving this
yeah,
for my...
he's fascinating. I love him.
I was saving this for Culture Corner because someone linked me to an idiot abroad.
I don't know, because a girlfriend of mine's from Manchester and calls him the prototypical Manchester man.
Just to explain, like, idiot abroad... And
it's
a spin-off from the Ricky Gervais podcast, and I, like, basically binge-watched the animated series they made out of that over the week. Because where Ricky Gervais and Stephen Merchant, they did a radio show together, but they discovered that their producer, Carl Pilkington, was this this sort of this fount of unintentional weird comedy
little unit, yeah,
because he just doesn't get anything,
and not in a malicious way. His in mind like an just, honest, yeah, just,
his mind just works in this really weird roundabout way that doesn't seem to understand.
It's amazingly logical, but it's missing a few cogs on the gear. So
yes, just the sort of mind of someone with no curiosity.
Yeah.
A man with no curiosity whatsoever. He just like hears something and then sort of just
doesn't care.
Just doesn't understand it. Expresses it through the filter of stupidity, and then just like
doesn't give a shit.
Just doesn't give a shit that he got all the facts wrong.
Yeah. I think what
it's what made it for me
was when he described like what is kind of like his aspirations in life, and it was like, I pay my own way, and that's just says it's like, oh, I have a job. It's like,
yeah, that's his thing. He's a man with no ambition whatsoever.
And I mean, like, it's okay to have like, I don't have much in the way of external ambition, but I have great internal ambition. So yeah,
and he keeps talking about how everyone just should stop inventing stuff.
Yeah,
because you know we're fine now. We're just faffing about at this point. It is a very sort of North of England busybody sort of attitude. Reminds me of my mum and dad in a couple of ways. My dad used to read the Daily Mail.
Which one? That's the stupid person one, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the insanely right-wing one. Which, in the 20s, doesn't like to talk about how it supported Oswald Mosley.
Who's Oswald Mosley, for the not British?
The guy who was trying to bring Nazism to Britain.
Okie dokie. Yeah, yes. They might not want to like discuss that.
Yes.
I say, this Hitler fellow's got a few top ideas. Okay, I can't bump this truck because it's full of explosives.
Yay. This was a mission in GTA 4.
I think it's... Shit! Okay, the brakes aren't that good on this.
I think it's a mission that comes up a lot in GTA games. Yeah. Because you have to think outside the driving really fast, smashing into things box. Yep, just obey the rules of the road for a while. That is an example of not obeying the rules of the road.
It's a creative interpretation. Oh, okay, good. The space bar brakes way better than just reverse.
Well, yes, I was watching the cartoon series of the Ricky Gervais Show, and there were bits when I was dying laughing. Apparently, at one point, it was the most downloaded podcast in the world. It's some of the funniest shit I've ever heard. It was a full booby booby bum bum moment.
Everybody loves booby bum bum.
Right, there's a bit where he's talking about war poetry. And he went into this sort of really weird, rambling, like hypothetical story in which he imagines being like a war widow who's stuck at home, and he gets sent a war poem from his husband. Husband, and,
I don't know and how he's that saying, didn't just kill me.
And he's saying, "But I didn't want a poem because that's not his words, is it? It's just stupid." And they were saying, "But when he was first courting you." You, Carl. Didn't he ever whisper sweet nothings into you? Wasn't he never romantic? He just and Carl said something like, "Now he's just like, get your knickers off, love." I couldn't breathe. Not the way it was the way it was presented.
I love it because it is a mind of pure pragmatism. Just anything else beyond the basic support of existence just doesn't matter.
I guess a mind perfectly satisfied with what it already knows.
It's kind of like the way I say, like, you can get to Zen through complex thought and work, or you can just stumble dick first into it. And I think that's what he's managed. It's like someone on their last life on the wheel before they attain enlightenment. He just doesn't care, doesn't need to. He's beyond it now. He's free.
You're starting.
How did I?
You lost a pursue person.
How long have we been doing this for? I want my life to end. That's
not happening. Long enough.
Shit.
Continue.
Do you want to take a shift?
No, I don't. Frankly.
Oh, come on.
I'm tired. I'm having to drive the conversation here.
Hey, guess what I could do if I wasn't having to do this?
Well, you wouldn't do it well enough.
Oh, bullshit. So this is what I mean. You've been waffling on this one. It's because I'm here distracted playing this shit. This is the to and fro of it.
Well, watching... Well, that's not helping at all, is it?
I don't have anything to do now for 2 months.
Well, what...
I'm just gonna exercise and play video games.
Shush.
I want to be a kept man.
Shush. Well, what the Carl Pilkington thing made me think of is that... I think we could all benefit from having an idiot around.
I know, we've discussed, like, Yahtzee wants to add an idiot, and I'm
well, we
like...
Don't, well, not to this, because the
ooh,
basically
gun.
The video games take the role of the idiot.
Idiot, yeah.
Yeah. But I look a bit like Stephen Merchant, and you look a bit like Ricky Gervais.
It is. It is kind of funny. And someone did a drawing of like us as like a splash page for this or some shit, and everyone, because I posted it on my Facebook wall because it was funny, and everyone's just like, "You look like professional wrestler Ricky Gervais."
Just a bit. And I'm very tall with a beard. And British.
And British. Yes, a tall, gawky British individual, which is essentially Stephen Merchant. The prototypical.
So, and I think one of the problems with our chemistry is that we both think we're smart.
Yeah.
And we both agree on a lot of stuff, barring a couple of things like
our disagreements are quibbles that we take far too seriously, and then get into squabbles about minutiae that most people don't really
care about. Disagreements
on
what is and what isn't a profitable use of your time, and when I should and should not bring up last time I had sex with a woman.
Oh, when?
Well,
come on, Yahtzee, you got to tell me now.
Well,
I'll tell you.
Let's not go into that.
It's been a while. Not for me.
Maybe if the world didn't base itself around judging each other on such a thing, Elliot Rodgers massacre might not have happened.
Not the world, me to you. Friends are allowed to tease each other about sex. It's what we do.
Well, we're talking to the world, and I am not going to talk about my sex life on this thing in any degree of close detail.
Anymore,
I should say.
Right, so anymore.
But you know,
you shouldn't either. Like, I mean, that's the thing. I go through huge, long dry patches. It doesn't stress me. It's not a concern. Don't worry about that shit.
Well, it doesn't stress me.
Yes, it does. You fucking grumble about it constantly. That's why I keep complaining to you about this. Is like, you need to not worry about this.
Well,
shit.
Why shouldn't I worry? Maybe I'm. Maybe my body is frustrated because a basic need is not being met. Maybe that is the problem.
Just gotta jerk off. Whoa! Hey there, champ. Jesus.
Look, man, I'm the fucking expert at jerking off. I can jerk off in ways that make my ears spin around. I'm a master
really?
At it.
See, if I could jerk off like that, I honestly would probably just go even longer stretches with that.
But there's more than just a grubby little squirt of fluid. It's about feeling the closeness and trust of another human.
So now we're getting somewhere. Yeah, you want emotional
connection.
It's
about feeling the closeness and trust of another human being.
You don't want to get laid, you want a girlfriend.
I want to play with a nice pair of jubblies as well.
Yahtzee, titty man!
And we can't all be sexless people like yourself.
Well, you know, I'm not sexless. Again, it's a matter of how you
sexless
construct...
people who whip themselves in the ghoulies with a cat of nine tails every night because you had a filthy thought.
I whip myself in the ghoulies with a cat of nine tails when I'm not having sex.
Well,
weirdo.
You do seem to take an inordinate smugness in not having sex.
No, I've just been... No, it's not a matter of smugness of not having sex. It's about not letting the lack of sex become a point of stress and pain for you.
Well, I can do other things besides stress about not having sex.
Yeah, good.
The human mind...
Slide. That was great.
That didn't seem like an advisable motion to make.
I just turned into Frogger. It was just like...
I'll just slide under this truck's tires. There we go.
Sweep!
Get back to Carl Pilgrimden, I think we could all benefit from having to explain something to an idiot now and then. Something that we take for granted, having to explain. Like explaining the concept of colour to a blind person. It's an interesting intellectual challenge.
Fascinating philosophical exercise.
Yes, so just explain, you know, chaos theory to someone like Carl Pilgrimden.
Come on. They won't care. Like, that's the thing. Like
the man who, you know, learns things and then filters it through idiocy.
Yes! I fucking made it!
Like, he was talking about, on the episode I saw, he was talking about the death of Herodotus. I think it was Herodotus. But in his mind, it had become the death of Plato.
I can understand how someone would make that mistake. Like, I've studied Greek history. It's easy to get a lot of these guys confused sometimes.
Well, famously, Herodotus died because an eagle dropped a tortoise on his head. Because that's how eagles fed off tortoises. They'd carry them up into the air and drop them on rocks to break their shells. But he, somewhere along the line, had decided that he was killed when an eagle laid an egg on his head.
All right.
And,
that's great.
And in his mind, he'd tried to make sense of it. He said that this was how eagles reared their young in ancient Greece.
You're born flying, kid. Yeah. Get it.
That's how they cracked open their eggs.
Why wait till they're like mature to push them out of the nest? Like that's, well, exactly. You know, that's a tiger mother attitude.
Yeah, so it's like the Chinese mothering program.
Yeah, you just gotta get them out there straight away, like a gymnast program for teens.
But what ties it all together is that he was using this analogy to illustrate the fact that Plato wasn't as smart as everyone gives him credit for.
Ow.
He was like saying, yeah, he's supposed to be a great smart guy. He got killed by an eagle off and on his head. See, and so they pressed him on that. And he said, well, if he hadn't been doing so well with his, you know, philosophy and the like, he wouldn't have been able to go on holidays and get hit by eagles dropping eggs. If he'd been working in a factory, that wouldn't have happened. And you just listen to him and your mouth sort of falls open.
See, a lot of the time I kind of understand where he's coming from. Like,
I don't know where he was coming from there.
Well, to me, I think, like, in his brain, there was the idea of how life is fleeting and there's a futility to it. So you spend all your time working on philosophy only to get killed by an eagle, in this case, laying an egg on you. And it's kind of, there's the humor in the absurdity. So I kind of get where he's coming from that. And then between that and his mouth, something happens.
Actually, I was...
Because a lot of the time with Pilkington, I do get the sense of what he's talking about. He just expresses it in a horrible way, and then Ricky starts teasing him mercilessly.
I was talking about this with my friend Stace this week. We were talking about the same thing, and...
I do think Ricky is a bit unfair to him.
I think I made the point that... I think he is a bit. But I think Ricky's, like, laughter is part of what makes it so infectiously funny.
Oh, yeah, well, he's legitimately pissing himself. But I mean, there is... Yeah. Again, I think there have been a few circumstances where Ricky's known what Carl has meant.
Yeah.
And has instead just decided to rip into him for, like, a very superficial interpretation
of that. I think that's why Steve's there.
He's there to
rein him in.
Because Ricky's just cruel to him sometimes. I mean, granted, for Idiot Abroad, that's very fucking funny.
We made the point that the thing with Carl Pilkington is that he basically orbits ideas.
Yeah.
Without actually internalizing them. And he may be able to have an idea in his head, but he seems to just lack the vocabulary.
Yeah, like, it's... Like, that's the thing. Like, I can peel back between, like, the fucking words he's used and say, okay, I can kind of think I might understand what he's going on about, but it's just...
Is it just a basically stolid mind?
Yeah, it just comes through and out this weird fucking spherical-headed mank.
Quite. So that was basically my culture corner. Did you have one?
Yeah, give me a mo. I just gotta... Yeah, can you steer this and do something, please? I don't want to do this anymore. It's upsetting me. I'm getting carpal tunnel.
I will write you, big baby.
Yeah, tag match. See, we did this the other time. Like, these are fun.
I will just follow the rules of the road while you talk.
I don't know if you can hear that. I'm cracking it near the microphone. That's my wrist.
Don't crack your bones to the mic.
I want people to understand that...
Some people are really grossed out by bone-cracking sounds.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. Weird.
Man, it's like playing Euro Truck Simulator all over again. Just tapping the forward keys so you don't accelerate too much.
Yeah, it's not fun. Alright, what have I done this week that wasn't...
I can usually crack my knuckles fairly juicily. Ooh, that was a nice one.
That was juicy. That was a lot. That was a good, like, all of them at once.
Yeah. I used to be able to crack my toes as well. Oh, there we go.
Jesus! I don't know if you heard that, but...
Yeah, they probably wouldn't have.
Probably wouldn't, but yeah.
I have...
It's fucking weird.
I have, like, this sort of inherited genetic abnormality where my toes are much... My big toe is much, much longer than my other toes.
It's fucking insane. I've seen it.
Yeah.
I think about... Every time I see it, I'm just like, good lord. How do you buy shoes?
Well, I buy a size larger than I probably should need. So, what was your culture corner?
I'm honestly struggling to remember. I saw a movie. What did I see?
Good on you.
I saw X-Men.
Oh.
Days of Future Past.
Oh. Yeah, the theme of these things seems to be you watching recent films, isn't it?
Well, I mean, I think it counterpoints... Well, I mean, Jodorowsky's Dune was a bit of an arty, weird one out of the corner. It was recent, but it was about an old film, so I think there was, you know, some validity to that. But I think it's a good counterpoint. Like, you tend to watch movies you should have seen a long time ago, and I keep up with the kids.
I can't remember the last time I went to the cinema, actually.
Did you watch a movie this week? Did you watch anything? Have you watched anything I recommended?
No, my thing was...
Carl Pilkington. Yeah, I thought you might have watched a movie as well. Alright, well, no, and I watched X-Men. It's kind of interesting.
Culture Corner can be any culture, remember?
Yeah.
Just as long as it's not video games, which we talk about all the time anyway.
1 week I'm going to discuss my passion for Hi-Li.
So how was Dies of Path... of Future Fast?
Well, I mean, It's one of those things where I enjoyed it. There is a lot that you could quibble about. Like, if you wanted to play the game of nitpick, you would rip this movie to shreds.
When you play the game of nitpick, you win or you waffle.
Well, I mean, things like... you know how in the other movies Ellen Page's character can move through walls?
Yes. Yes. He's playing...
Shadowcat. Yeah, a very, very... I think an original team member, if not very early.
Realistically speaking, the moment she used that, she should just disappear, because the Earth will have moved on without her.
Thanks, Yahtzee. She can now just send people back in time for no reason. Like, and it's
okay.
How
does that work then?
She just touches their heads and magically sends people via their own consciousness.
What?
Back in time. Yeah. And the thing is, in Days of Future Past, that's another mutant, which would have been real easy because they've already got a carnival of other mutants in the future section for Days of Future Past.
I call big fat sweaty bollocks.
Oh yeah, and it's really frustrating because they could have just as easily said...
Why did I stop there?
Because you hit a corner.
That's dumb physics, that is.
They could have just as easily done... Because, I mean, I think in... I can't remember if it's in actual X-canon, but Beast's... You know, mutations have been growing and changing. Like, Beast has been getting more and more, like, beast-looking. Yeah. So, they could have easily just had an explanation of powers have been growing and changing. Shadowcat, for some reason, can do this now. They could have added another actual fucking mutant.
It's like in Heroes.
Yeah,
instead... The powers would just get better and better and better, but, and then they'd realize, oh, shit, and then they'd just depower everyone.
Oh, God, that was a terrible show. Heroes' shouldn't have been that from the start, like... You don't get time travel involved from season 2.
Well, his arc was that he took a long time to master his powers, but then there wasn't much they could do with him.
Again, that's the problem. When you can control space, or you bounce around through space and time just at a blink, it's a big problem then to give that human being a reasonable threat. Like it's an issue.
Yeah, it's so anyway.
There's a lot of little things like that. Like if that bothers you heaps, don't go see this movie because it is full of little moments. The Quicksilver moment is quite cool, but it's like so clearly just sandwiched in for no other reason than to have Quicksilver in it. Like he's not, he gets, it's strange. It's almost a completely separate part of the film. Like it's related to the main plot in that they need to get Magneto, but it's just Quicksilver. We need your help to do this. Okay, bye, Quicksilver. And then they go off, and he's just not in the movie for the rest of it.
What's the button for getting out?
Shift. Other shift.
Thank you.
There we go. Which is kind of a bummer because the Quicksilver sort of sequence when he's busting Magneto out is actually quite cool.
I'm gonna catch a train.
I mean, the sad thing is, if it had been some sensibly organized from the start 3 or 4 movie saga that really built Days of Future Past, it would have been like fucking amazing.
Well, isn't that kind of what they did? They just sort of tied all the previous X films together?
Oh, tied. No. They've basically deleted.
Well, like, people do that all the time these days.
Yeah, but it's interesting because it's...
Hope you weren't attached to the Next Generation cast. Erase.
Yeah. It's rare to see it's the first, I think, in cinema, in-universe reboot without just changing the cast. Because, to be fair, X-Men, I think, is probably one of the best cast, with a few exceptions.
I hope they never reboot Next Generation Star Trek with a new cast.
Why would they do that?
It just wouldn't be the same.
I don't think there's any need to do that whatsoever. You could just go, here's another Star Trek series.
Hey,
which reminds me,
here's
fucking,
my train.
Here's another Star Trek series. You fucking retard.
Well, what? That's not how train platforms work. Right, I'm bitter.
Wasted shit nuggets. So basically, at the end of the film...
Oh, that's a fast one.
Yeah, has at least deleted everything after the original X-Men, if not just rewritten it. So, like, spoilers if you're a twit. Jean Grey, Cyclops, they're all alive at the end. The events of... Last Stand don't appear to have happened at all, which is great, because that movie is awful, and Brett Ratner's a turd.
Okay.
That means, like, X-Men Wolverine, that's just, you know, that can be ignored now, like the Japanese one that was really boring. Origins is also up for grabs now, considering that in the end of Days of Future Past, it's Mystique pretending to be Stryker that takes Wolverine.
What's the button for shoot gun?
D...
What is please D?
So my left hand has get in car, get out, and shoot, and kind of like a organized
Continue.
Yahtzee, give me sex or I'll murder everyone, Kershaw. So basically, like, it's kept a cast and a universe that has had decent work put into it, and I think has produced some really good films. X-Men 1 and 2 I really enjoy. Loser. And... But then, yeah, just otherwise entirely rebooted the narrative and set up for Apocalypse as a villain for the next movie. But, you know, now the next movie is going to be interesting. Like, are they going to do a first class era movie? Are they going to do it, you know, in the current X-Men universe? Like, are they going to do another sort of modern X-Men movie, which I really like to see?
Well, would you rather be trapped in a lift with James McAvoy or Patrick Stewart in which case?
Oh, well, Patrick Stewart.
Oh, I don't know. I'd be, like, sweating with Patrick Stewart, because I'd be afraid of not impressing him. Whereas James McAvoy, I feel I could just talk to.
See, I don't know, like, I get the feeling, like, Patrick Stewart you could just have a conversation to with if you just treated him like a human being.
Well, I suppose
like,
most
if you
of
just
my...
like, oh my god,
I suppose most of my image of Patrick Stewart I take from Captain Picard. And he did not suffer fools gladly.
Well, I don't think that's Patrick Stewart. Like, I mean, if you
no,
see,
I don't,
like...
I don't know either, but it's just the image that's kind of indelibly lodged of him that I have.
I actually think I'd probably be easier talking to Patrick Stewart than James McAvoy. I mean, that's not to say James McAvoy's probably not a really personable, you know, person, but I think if you were gentle and polite about it and weren't, like, just fawning and being an anus, you could probably get into a reasonable, flowy conversation with Patrick Stewart just if you were both trapped in an elevator.
I think Patrick Stewart is a bit of one of those Hollywood lovies we were talking about when we were disparaging the Academy Awards. He is quite lovey. Well, of course, British theatre was doing lovies before Hollywood was even a glint in the milkman's eye.
Yep.
Oscar Wilde, for example.
I mean... Yeah, you know,
lovies is a very specific term.
Okay, what do you mean by that?
Lovies, people like Stephen Fry. Stephen Fry is like the archetypal lovey.
Very just friendly and supportive of everybody. Or...
Yeah, but in a sort of almost sort of mawkish kind of way. Darling, follow your dreams, then you'll
have dreams that are followed.
You will win the day.
I think there's a place in the world for that. You know, in the sort of broader ecosystem, I think it's important to have a few people who are just...
Well, I suppose we have to have everyone from all sides of the spectrum.
Yeah, you need a few. I mean, I can understand, like, it would get fucking grating, particularly for me, because, you know, that kind of thing would just rub on me after a little while, but I mean, it's not their fault, that's more of a me problem.
Yes. As long as we have you, we also need non-twats for the full spectrum.
Well, just the other spectrum of twats. We're all twats.
No, I don't think...
You gotta kill Frenzy! Get out!
Kill Frenzy time!
Supposed to kill things in the kill Frenzy, Yahtzee.
What? That was easy! You asshole!
That sucked.
That was hardly a
That's
kill
not even
frenzy.
A frenzy!
I blew up one car.
We were looking at this earlier, there's like technical definitions for like frenzies and sprees. Wait, we didn't find Frenzy.
I don't think frenzy is a technical definition. We were looking up what constitutes a massacre, because we were talking about all the shootings there have been lately. Apparently there's no official definition of a massacre, it's just multiple...
It seemed to suggest multiple aggressors.
Well, you say that, but the Sandy Hook massacre was called...
Yeah, that was called a massacre, but it was one guy. I don't know, the Wikipedia article started with it being...
It said a group or organization committing multiple killings of helpless people.
That's so like a big war can't be a massacre because it's between two sets of soldiers, but like a bunch of soldiers killing a village, that's
I've still heard of like massacres in battle if one side is like desperately outclassed by the other.
I think maybe if the killing is really like, if you didn't have to kill them, like if the day was won and you just went and killed them all anyway.
You ain't taking me alive, coppers. Oh,
did
bugger,
you just
I'm
park
stuck.
Yourself in a you
I can't reverse, it won't reverse. I don't know what the hell happened there.
You'll never take me...
2D physics, eh?
You took me alive.
Well,
that's sad.
On that note, just a quick reminder, please don't massacre anyone.
Yeah, or spree kill people.
Because that's not how you make friends.
And your problems are solvable.
If you got no friends and no one wants to have sex with you, that's basically the opposite of the thing you should be doing.
This'll win him over. It's just like that guy that tried to get Jodie Foster's attention.
don't buy into E3, don't be an idiot, and don't be Gabriel.
E3 and massacres, just say no.
Anything else to conclude with? Do you want to apologize for not being here last week, maybe? Do you want to maybe do that?
Apologizing suggests that this is an obligation. Sorry, you fucking
could
whining
cunts. Could you at least apologize to me?
I meant, it's not like I just didn't show up. I mentioned in advance, hey, I've got a lot of university work. I've got to, like, I don't think I can spend, like, the 5 hours that it takes me to come over here, leave, etc., etc.
If I went on a massacre tomorrow, it would be all your fault. Good night, everybody.